a car without a driver. So it really needs a lot of sensors and cameras and has to detect what objects are seen. So the driver sees there's a sky, there's a road, there's another car, and these are also important for the object classification. That is one of the important things that can be done by trained neural networks. Yeah? But there, as we heard, there is not just one, there are many neural networks working all close together to get actually this car driving. Here, if we have a picture, even on a still picture, we can define how many objects we want to see, the sky, the grass, and the beach. Or do we want to have four of them? Then we also have the sea around there. And what's inside of the neural network, there are different layers. So it's a deep convolutional network. And in the different layers, we have different areas that are getting activated for the sense ownership, for example, or another cells are getting active if the grass is detected. And so we don't really know how it works inside of the deep neural network, but somehow there are some cells like synapses in the brain that gets activated by input parameters. And the input parameter is each pixel of the input picture. Yeah? This is the input, and the output is then, okay, we have an output pin that is activated when the grass is detected. So if you have it on a graphical way here in two dimension or even in three dimension, we see the grouping that here is a cluster of some neurons getting activated, and this means it represents that, for example, the grass is detected. Or here, when we go to the use case of the self-driving car, we see this is a passenger car, or this is an SUV that is detected, or a pedestrian, or a car sign, or the road, whatever you want to detect. And you decide during the training phase what should be the output of this neural network. So in the case of self-driving cars, with our partner NVIDIA, we have a whole family of hardware. For example, this box here has also this NVIDIA GPU on it, but this is the device that is placed into the car during the inference phase. So when it's already trained, the car itself gets a trained network, and then it decides if the cameras are seeing, for example, the road goes to the left, you have to put the steering wheel to the left. Otherwise, you will go off the track, and you want to avoid it. So here, the input are the cameras that are combined to one picture, or even a whole model of the real world. So you make inside of the car, you make a model of your real environment with the other cars, with all the sensors around, and then this model gets fed into the neural network or the cameras, and then the decision is in which direction you have to put the wheel, or you have to brake, or to speed up, or whatever. So this is in a very principled way how it works. But before having the trained network, you have to train it. And this is not done within the car during driving. That would be too risky. This can be done offline. So you take a lot of data, labeled data of a normal car that drives on the road with all the sensors and cameras. And as an output, you know what the experienced driver makes when he sees this situation. The road goes to the left, he has to put the steering wheel to the left. So you know already the output. So you start to train a network, all the different layers get hours and hours of car driving scenes, and later on you get a new picture, and you test the network, what is the reaction of it. And if it makes no error or no accident, you say, okay, now it's good enough to drive the car by itself. Yeah? So that's the principle. You feed the network with labeled data. The label is what is the output, what the expected output. You train the network, all the different layers here, and later on you test the network if it really behaves as expected. So here are these pictures. You see what are the different layers of this picture of the road is in the different layers in the neural network, how it's represented. And this is done with a very low resolution. So all the high resolution sensors on the car, they are to save memory space, it's a much easier picture that is really trained into the network. And then you have the full cycle. You see something in front of your car or in surrounding, and as an output you know how to where to go. Interesting is that in a deep convolution network, not every pixel is interesting, but there are some zones that are more important for the next driving situation. And these are, for example, here, the objects that would cross your direction, or the edges of the street are more important than the middle of the street. So these are the areas that are getting activated. And NVIDIA has shown on a show how this can be. They are calling it Holodesk, yeah? So it's a good name. So they really make some virtual environment where this driver here has a VR camera on his head. He sits in another city, but what he's actually doing is he controls this model of the car that is really in reality outside of a building, and he drives it into a parking lot. Yeah? Very slow, but at least it's a beginning. And that scenario is also important when you see, for example, all the trained neural networks, they are not error-free. So there might be a situation where the neural networks say, oh, I don't know where to drive, it's better that I stop. And then somebody has to take over the control of the car and finish the parking maneuver or whatever. So all this comes together. It's not only just to have one neural network in the car, but you need a whole ecosystem around it. You need map data that exactly shows the car where it's located, in which lane on the street, or what are the traffic situations around the car. And so there comes a lot of different systems together that are actually needed to have this self-driving car in the level 5, so of the really autonomous driving. So at the moment we are having more and more small, intelligent, independent systems getting built within the cars, but we still need some years until it's really affordable, such a car. Yeah? So right now it's more and more testing. But it's impressive that we make big progress, and also the car manufacturers have or agreeing or during development they have seen, no, it's more complex than they want to have it as they started. So it costs a lot of money and effort. So they are combining all the resources and they are building clusters of companies with the same interest. So they all want to have this autonomous driving, but they know it's such a big task for every single car manufacturer or OEM, or car suppliers, it's too expensive. So they really get together in groups, they develop together, but at the end, everybody also competing against each other. So they want to have the freedom to be a little bit better than the others. Yeah? So collaboration, but being better than the others. Yeah? So it's hard, but it makes sense. So all the OEMs and navigation system manufacturers, and so they are coming closer together. Here's a history about the timeline. BMW started 2013, Volkswagen, Daimler follows, then Volvo and Renault, so PSR with Citroën, they are right now here, and here are all the pictures how the cars are looking, and you have new dashboards, new user interfaces, so there comes a lot together. Also, the map manufacturers, they are developing high-resolution maps that are also detecting the surrounding of the car and matching it to the map data, and all in all, you get an architecture that not only drives you to your target, but also you get more layers that really controls this highly automated driving. So you have to know on which lane you are, what are the weather conditions. So it's getting more complex than just navigation. And for that, you also need a network and a connection to the cloud, to the internet, because you need real-time data from a lot of other systems that are fed. For example, you can then see where is the next parking lot, or you can see what are the condition of the road and so on. So it all gets interconnected. You have an IoT network and real-time data and massive amount of data, and all the different systems, they have to be tested and working smoothly together, hopefully. So it's impressive how many data there are really needed to get to the target of a real autonomous driving car. And all in all, it's a new picture of the mobility of the people. So it's not only about the autonomous car driving by itself, but there is the electromobility coming together, and all the CO2 debates and the Dieselgate, and everything comes together, and you get more and more complex systems all around it. So the software platform from IBM, and we are in the data center during the training, very heavily involved. These are pre-tested libraries, so we take the open source from the TensorFlow, we make hardware optimization for our hardware. For example, we have this NVLink between CPU and GPU, and we have a special version of the Nickel library. We also have heard this name here. So we are allowing not only to scale within the box with more than one GPU, but we are also allowed to scale out of the box in a cluster with tens or hundreds or even thousands of nodes. Last week, IBM has announced the fastest computer on the world, even faster than the Chinese computer. It has 4,600 nodes of the AC922 machine, and that's exactly the Power AI machine with the 4 or 6 GPU when it's water cooled. And we have worked in the energy department in the US, so there are different research institutes working together to really put load on this big cluster of this mighty machine. We have 4,600 nodes, and we are beating all other HPC, so high performance computer. Even here in Feingen, we also have a high HPC cluster, but there is a top 500 list, and it's expected that the IBM cluster from this energy department in the US will be number one. So we have a lot of optimization done for you to really support the hardware and get the best result, but because at the end, it's important for a data scientist that this turnaround cycle that we have learned. So we tune the learning mechanism, and then we have to rerun all the tests. And this development cycle has to be very fast. So when it's double the speed, for example, the data scientist can do more work within the same time. So the limiting factor is a turnaround cycle, and when it's speed up by the factor of 2, and that's what we see compared to other platforms, so you can do twice the work, and that's a great success. with the Power AI platform, there also come this tool Visions, that's an add-on, where you can analyze pictures. For example, here's a small hummingbird here. You see in the network the red area that is most important for recognition, and you see, okay, it's a small bird. But this is not only can be done for still images, but also for movies. Yeah. So it helps you to label the data, and label data, that's the input to train your network, and it's very time and labor intensive to label all the gigabytes or huge amounts of data. And so you start to label some of your objects, and then let the network do the labeling for the next frames for you, and then you can have an iterative process that you correct the network by hand, and then retrain it or rerun it again, and later on you get all your data labeled in less time than doing it manually. Yeah. And here we have an example where we are labeling in a supermarket to differentiate objects, the trolley from the person, and we are even possible to recognize the age of the people in the supermarket. I can show it. So I just make a jump. Also here you are labeling all the cards, and then later on, when it's running, you can differentiate between the trolleys and the persons, and the age of the people is displayed, but it's not in years, but it says it's a young person or a middle-aged person or an elder person. And that, for example, is interesting for the job owner to see what are your customers are buying. Yeah. So here you have the elder and the middle-aged. And that's the latest technology here for the Power AI Vision. And that's the same technology that was called IBM Video Analytics before. That's the technology for all the surveillance cameras and so on to really detect objects and prevent from attacks. And this is all a semi-automatic process of labeling all the video streams. Yeah? So you train the network with these objects, and later on you just put the camera in the supermarket and automatically it counts the trolleys and the buyers that are passing by. Yeah. Okay, so we have done for the car manufacturers, we have worked, or I did a proof of concept with Continental. They not only make tires, but they also make assistant systems like parking and brake, emergency brake systems and so on. Then with the Volkswagen Data Lab in Munich, they were interested in PTorch and MXNet. But it was interesting for me to hear, it's what not directly autonomous driving, but they are also interested to have a neural network trained to detect if there are anomalies in a network. So they have to ensure all the ecosystem around the autonomous driving and to protect against anomalies like hackers. They have to observe or control the network that it's really in a stable condition all the time, because it's a security relevant network. Yeah. So I'm ahead in time. I have time for some questions.